the sun went in, which does make a difference with this work.
It's got a kind of fake dirt.
The Charles Wollaston Award is one of the most valuable art prizes in Britain. It's worth £25,000 to the winner, the same amount as the Turner Prize. The judges of this year's award are artist Gavin Turk, art critic Martin Herbert, curator Judy Collins, and this year's summer exhibition coordinator Stephen Chambers.
It's enriched by being here, isn't it? Yes.
They've spent the morning drawing up a short list of six works, one of which will be judged the most distinguished in the show.
We very much admire the execution, but it has to be perfect, doesn't it?
There are four paintings on the list by Nicola Tyson, Gillian Ayres, Tal R and Jane Harris. And two sculptures by Alison Wilding and Yinka Shonibari.
So we've reached the very final part of the judging process. They've narrowed down more than 1,000 works of art, the entire contents of the exhibition, to a shortlist of just six. There's already a lot of blood in the water, but this is where the real arguments begin.
The first work up for discussion is a painting by Nicola Tyson, on display in Fiona Ray's room.
It reminds me of all kinds of things, but in a very distorted way. This two-tier arrangement, very theatrical, scenographic, makes me think of Francis Bacon's metamorphic figures, except this is a Francis Bacon figure, well, kind of, reimagined for the 21st century.
She's got just a way with the figure, and there's something very off and uneasy about her presentation of the figure.
Yes, because you look, the figure's face is shrouded. Mm.
It's quite harrowing. It's quite a visceral painting.
A small tabletop sculpture by Alison Wilding is next on the list.
I think what she's trying to do is create a kind of abstract equivalent to an emotional situation. I think it speaks to me about the sense of isolation, perhaps a sense of being trapped in a field of whiteness, being enclosed.
You can actually walk through a gallery with an Alison Wilding sculpture and not see it.
Yes.
I mean, they are such enigmatic, quiet things, but when you come back and have your attention drawn to it, they then grow.
Quietness turns to loudness with the next work on the list, a colourful painting by Gillian Ayres called Amalfi, which is showing alongside five other paintings of hers.
Gillian Ayres is 80 this year, and I think this whole wall hung with her work is a kind of birthday present to her from the Royal Academy. Lots of light, lots of colour, lots and lots of paint.
I just thought that this display of her work here, these six works, look really fantastic in this room. And I think it's probably the strongest sort of work of hers I've ever seen.
She represents an area of art which is perhaps, she does that kind of crossover that reaches to a wide range of people.
This painting by Tal R is next to be discussed by the judges. Its title is Minus Yesterday, Minus Tomorrow.
It's not a lot of help in deciphering it, really, the title, is it? Very theatrical. It's a depiction of Venice, but it could be Venice recreated in Las Vegas, reimagined through the mind of a very postmodern artist. He lives in Denmark, apparently. And it is said that he's got seven separate studios. So, whatever I might think, he's doing okay.
If you didn't know the work before, you might think an outsider art or whatever. Mm. But actually, I think he really knows what he's doing.
As far as I know, these were a series of minus paintings, and they were all about subtraction in some way. So he said, I'm only going to have this set of colours, and I'm only going to have maybe a limited number of forms, and the forms have to repeat in certain ways.
The second sculpture in the running for the prize is by Yinka Shonibari.
It's hard to describe what he does exactly. You might know his work from the fourth plinth at the moment. There's the ship in a bottle. I think they're kind of tangled allegories of objects. They're meant to make you think, provoke thought. And this one, I was wondering what it symbolised, and then I suddenly came round to the front and I saw the number plate, footsie. So I think it's evidently meant to be some kind of symbol of the current financial crisis. I'm not sure whether that makes me like it more or less.
It's the best Yinka Shonibari I have seen. Ever.
There you go.
God, hyperbole.
That's a big thing.
Yes.
It does seem to work on several levels as well. You can take simply the crashed car and the footsie aspect, or you can take the cultural, historical aspects of it.
To, in a way, like fit this kind of sculpture into the Royal Academy, which is a very colonial and very classical building. It actually like builds the work and actually like increases the power of the piece.
The final work on the shortlist is by painter Jane Harris.
I'm wondering if the title Divine is meant to conjure up clouds and heaven and gold and paradise, or is it meant actually as an invitation? Divine me, guess me, work me out, figure me out. I think it's the first. I think it's meant to be a sort of ironic postmodern vision of heaven. I must say I like this. I've not come across her work before.
It's a painting where the brush strokes are designed to catch light, and it's in natural light, so as you stay in the room with it, you feel it change in front of you.
What's nice about it is that it does sort of splice together this, if you like, quite male, I think, hard-edged painting with a more decorative and more kind of curious sort of doily.
This is crunch time. This is where they actually have to narrow those six down to just one, winner takes all. The title of the most distinguished work in this year's Royal Academy Summer Exhibition. Who's it going to be?
Let's go for it.
Okay.
I'm going to give you Talar.
I think that he probably is a very strong contender, but personally, for me, it's Yinka Shonibare's piece.
I would go for Yinka myself because I think it's an extraordinarily good piece.
His piece is something very special. Mm-hmm. It is.
Yinka. I'm pushed off the end of the pier. We have a decision. We have Yinka.
Well done, Yinka.
Very good.
So, Yinka Shonibare it is. Car crash or masterpiece? It's certainly going to be one of the talking points of this year's show.
Congratulations again to the winner of this year's Wollaston Prize. Now, as we've seen, the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition is a bit of a curious mix, showing contemporary art within a framework of pageantry and ritual that goes back all the way to the 1760s. It shouldn't work, and yet, somehow or other, it does. Now, one of the oldest traditions of all is the RA Annual Dinner, the highlight of which is a speech given by a prominent public figure. This year's after-dinner speaker is Stephen Fry.
Once known as the first dinner in Europe, the annual dinner was conceived as an event where artists would get to rub shoulders with the great and the good of Britain's establishment.
Gentlemen, Sir Laurence Olivier.
Now, this year I've been invited to join the illustrious crowd of big cheeses, but the Royal Academy Annual Dinner isn't just an excuse for a party, it's also meant to be the occasion for an important speech about the nature of British culture. And this year, Stephen Fry is going to be doing the honours. I'm intrigued to see what he has to say.